So when, as a human beings, we think about decision making, mm-hmm. right? You have these emotional states going on, you have this planning, you have some previous experiences. How do you define decision making in humans and mm-hmm. in non-human animals, for example?
So in general, there's a lot of continuity between non-human animals and humans in terms of the general way they make decisions. Mm-hmm. And so you already described like two or three different things, and we can talk about those two or three different things, like planning, memory that we have before, and maybe some immediate effect of reward. And we can think about all of those in animals too. And this is, then becomes, you know, super interesting to think about what that looks like in animals. So let's start off with planning, right? That's, in some sense, that's the most sophisticated thing we think of humans as doing. And indeed, there are cases where we can plan, you know, think of classically, you know, playing a game of chess or something, you know, thinking of like a game, you actually think, you try to think steps forward in the world. Now, people try to operationalize the same sorts of problems that require planning, a little bit of planning in that way in animals. Indeed, this is what Tom was interested in, you know, in his cognitive maps in men and animals. Basically, he was interested exactly in this thing. And so he was being criticized by some psychologists at the time, saying, you know, he's leaving animals, quote, buried in thought. And so we have evidence about the sorts of plan, some evidence about the sorts of planning that animals can do. We know something about the neural substrates of that planning. And then things like, you know, people think about things like pre-play or in the hippocampus. So different sorts of rhythms in the hippocampus, which may be involved in some aspects of this. And we think about other algorithms that animals are doing. And indeed, you know, Tolman was very interested in the cognitive maps. Once you have a map, you know, a map is a nice structure to have, but what you really want to do with a map is planning. And so that's exactly what Tolman was interested in doing. And then he was then trying to design experiments to look at those things. And then take Pavlovian conditioning. So we go to the other extreme, where Pavlovian conditioning, where you just say, well, this is all I'm, what's happening there is that I make a prediction about some aspect of the world because I see a cue. And there's a set of actions which are automatically elicited by that prediction. So for instance, if I see something which predicts future reward, I tend to approach and engage with it. If I see something which predicts a punishment, I tend to withdraw and remove myself from it. So we did a test in humans. So working with Mark Guicot Massip and using basically a design that came from Molly Crockett, we did what we call the orthogonalized go-no-go task, if I might just describe it briefly. Mm-hmm. So what we wanted to do was to essentially pit instrumental conditioning against Pavlovian conditioning to see how powerful Pavlovian conditioning is in humans, mm-hmm. right? So, and something you can do in animals too. So the idea is the following. We have four conditions. The one condition, you get rewarded if you make an active response in response to a cue. Mm-hmm. Another condition is you avoid a punishment if you make an active response to a cue. Mm-hmm. Third condition is you avoid a punishment if you do nothing in response to a cue. And the fourth condition, as you might imagine, is you get a reward if you do nothing in response to a cue. Mm. So from a rational point of view, there's nothing different about any of these quadrants. There's an operant action you should do. There's a correct thing, either go or no go. So do something, go. Do avoid doing something, no go. And in some cases, you get a reward. That's good. Other cases, you avoid a punishment. That's also good. So you should just do that. So we might expect, you know, good quality humans to do exactly the right thing. But from a perspective of Pavlovian instrumental conditioning, something different happens. Because there, as I mentioned, if you have a cue which predicts reward, you tend to engage and act actively towards it. And the concomitantly, so the converse of that is if you have a cue which predicts a punishment, you tend to withdraw and withhold in that case. So we can predict that two of these actions combinations should be easy. So go to get a reward should be easy because the cue says you know, you'd like to go because it's a positive and you'd get a reward, which is also good for doing it. And no go, so do nothing in order to avoid a punishment, should be easy too, because then, you know, that's also congruent, essentially, where Pavlovian and instrumental contingencies are congruent. But the other two, they're incongruent, right? Mm-hmm. So one says you have to do something actively to avoid a punishment. So you know the punishment, you know, the prediction of a punishment makes you want to stop. So that's going to be a little bit difficult. And then the fourth one, you think that's the easiest one possible. A cue comes up, you do nothing, you get a reward. So it turns out that that's the most difficult one for our human subjects to learn. So we did a task where we had each of these contingencies, and a third of our subjects, or our participants in this study, in I think 40 trials, never learned not to go in order to get a reward. So they always, you know, even though, you know, they were basically reducing their own reward. So that shows that although you might think that we are, you know, capable of beating our Pavlovian, our inner Pavlov, we are not. And so we have we suffer from some of these same problems. And so I wrote a paper with some colleagues. We called it Pavlovian misbehavior, basically. So it's a misbehavior that comes because of these things. And we think it's actually very important for a number of different, even psychiatric conditions as well. Mm-hmm. And if you think of yourself maybe on a diet, for instance, you know, then you know, you find yourself, you know, if you walk past a bakery store where, you know, there's a beautiful smell of, you know, cream cakes wafting out of the door, you find yourself, you know, even though you might be on a diet, you find yourself, you know, having finished this cream cake that you then couldn't help yourself but buy. So now, of course, you're a good quality human, right? So you think, well, what I'm going to do is when I leave my home, I'm going to plan a, you know, huge route and huge detour around so I don't tempt myself by the cream bun store. So we do have the capacity to beat off these mm-hmm. Pavlovian instincts, mm-hmm. and indeed, after 2/3 of our subjects in the end, they did learn how to do it. But we are still subject to them, and the more subject you are, and if you're distracted, you're doing a dual task, you're going to become more subject to it, and under certain psychiatric conditions, we think you're more subject to it too. So these are very powerful. You know, we build these mechanisms that are inside our heads. We can't just avoid them, and they're causing trouble, basically.